very, very free, Pentecostal, whatever you want to call it. And I don't think it matters. Born again is what it takes. But sometimes I wonder where the joy went that used to be there. You know, when I was growing up, if you mentioned heaven just a couple of times, you had a shout and run around. People wanted to hear about heaven. They wanted to hear about heaven. But the Bible said they would be saying in the end, when is he coming? I thought he was coming. You said he was coming. He's not here yet. Where is he at? Well, he's still coming. And we're closer now than we was yesterday. Just a few more days to labor and we'll be there. Heaven is sounding sweeter. And I'll tell you something. The story of heaven, the story of Jesus, is the most truest story there has ever been told. The greatest thing that's ever happened to you and me is we got to meet the Christ. Amen. And so you need to kind of check yourself tonight and find out if you know that you know that you know. Now you can know without a doubt, and you can know with doubt. We don't have to doubt. I carry a handkerchief. Somebody's got to have it tonight. I don't know who you are. But God ordered this. Handkerchiefs and aprons were sent from Paul's body. Diseases, sicknesses, and deliverance was there. This is on order from the Lord. This is the only reason I do this. It's His order. Nothing in me, nothing I can do. I'm so helpless without Him. But He has given unto me the power to bring to you a word. And I don't doubt the fact that the word is going to heal you tonight. Now the word of God is alive. The word of God is just not words in a book. The word of God is alive. And He said He sent His word to heal you. And tonight, you want to be healed? Take heed to what the word is saying. The word is full of power. The word is still real. I was sitting in my home the other day, and I was reading. And I was sitting at my desk, and I saw this red writing. And I said, look at that. I'm talking to myself. Look at that, Jesus. You said that. You said that. That's for real. Them words are alive. You said that. And that is for real. Jesus was so powerful that when I went on the mount where He taught the Beatitudes, where He preached to the disciples love and mercy and having all of the things that we've got to have to give to other people. When I went up on that hillside, I was standing there looking at the hillside, and I said, oh God, I could have just enjoyed that so much. And tonight, if we take for granted the word of God, the word of God is getting less and less because people are getting afraid and more afraid and more afraid. They're drawing back more, and they think a shiny suit or a shiny dress is going to make the difference. But it will not. It does not make you important. It does not make you special. It don't make you better than anybody. It don't help you at all. If you want to get close to God, shiny sequins and nice clothes will not help you none. But I'll tell you what will help you. Get in the war room. Get in the war room. Start warring against that enemy that's fighting your house. Start warring against that enemy that wants to steal your family. Start warring against that enemy that's took your joy, that's took your peace. Because I know the man that can. The little song said, I can't walk on the water and I can't calm the sea, but I know the man that can. I can't make blind eyes open, but I know the man that can. I can't heal the sick, but I know the man that can. I said, I know him. I don't know about him. I know that he lives. Hallelujah. I know that he lives, and I know that he reigns, and I know that he said for me to be like him. Amen. And I'm so thankful that I have a hungry and a thirst to be like him. If I'm not like him, maybe I don't know him. I believe the Bible said if we don't love our brother, we don't know God. Somebody said, how does, tell me what that means. I said, it means what it said. If you don't love your brother, you don't know God. That scares some of us, don't it? Because there's a few people that we don't like to spend a lot of time around, but they won't let us. There's a lot of things I would do that they won't let me do. Some says, now, Sister Wanda, you take your time but hurry. Take your time but hurry. Yeah, don't take up too much time, because my people, here's the way they talk. My people, my people won't know what to do with that. Pastor told me just a couple of weeks ago, said a pastor come to visit him. And he said, the pastor told him, said, this would kill my people. That's a shame. That's a shame that a pastor would be afraid of the power of God. It's a shame that he's got little sheep out there and they're starving to death and he's hollering, my people couldn't take that. Well, he needs to let them try it, don't he? He needs to let them try it. Maybe there wouldn't be so many in the hospital if he had let him try it. Amen. The Spirit of God will set you free. The Word of God will send deliverance and healing and give you all the power you need to overcome the enemy. The devil don't have to be afraid of us anymore, because we're still. I'm not going to do nothing, I promise. He says, well, you better not. You say, okay. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. I'm not going to. But I am. But I am. I'm going to say, shut up and sit down. I'm talking. Shut up and sit down. I'm preaching. You know, for years I preached and I called myself a witness. For years they'd say, do you preach? I said, I'm a witness. But today I'd like to say, by the Holy Ghost that lives in me, I am nothing without him, but the preacher lives inside of me, and he's alive and well, and he makes me to know that I can make it to the finish line, and nothing by any means shall harm me. If I go down and I don't come back, if I don't get back to Kentucky, if I don't get from Kentucky back here again, don't worry about me. Just meet me in the morning. Just meet me in the morning, because that's all they're going to be there, daylight. I like daylight, don't you? I'm a child of the light. Amen, I'm a child of the light. I don't like dark. I don't like dark nights. I don't like dark houses. Amen. But I know one thing, there's peace in the storm for the children of God. Don't let the devil steal your joy. Don't let him steal your stuff. Amen. But I was reading, and I'm going to try to get to that. I get so wound up and so happy that I say the first thing last and the last thing first. But I guess the Bible quoted that too. Amen. And so I got to reading, and I seem to be talking a lot about Moses. You know, I feel for Moses because I used to lead people. I used to lead people, and I loved it with all of my heart. But them little fellas, I tell you, some of them would cry, some of them would fight, some of them would fuss, and some of them would say, well, I don't know why you did that. Look what you did. Look at that. Why don't you do this? The carpet needs to be this color. The seat needs to be that color. You need not to do it that way. You need to do it this. I mean, you know, blah, 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 blah. Bless their little hearts. And so somebody got to get strong and say, hey, here's what we're going to do. Here's what we're going to do. And so, you know, God called me full time, and I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now, I'm going to preach what you give me. I'm going to let the pastor pet his children. Amen. I'm going to preach what you give me, and I'm going to let the pastor pet you. Amen. But if you don't get the truth of God, and you don't get something with fire in it, you have got nothing. If you don't get something that'll set you free, you have wasted your visit. If you don't get something that makes you feel better when you leave, you have come and wore yourself out for nothing. But I want to start out with Moses was in Exodus 33 and 14. He said, God said to Moses, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And he said unto him, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. Lord, if you're not going with me, I'm not going. Lord, if you're not going to watch over me with your presence, I'm not getting up, because people make me nervous. I'm natural born nervous. I don't like to get up in front of people. And look what the Lord done to me. I said, Lord, I don't want to do that. He said, do it or die. Well, I said, I want to live just a little while. I'll try. But I'm here to tell you, if you don't get serious with God and say, God, if you don't go, I'm not going. God, if you don't go with me, I'm staying home. I don't need this stuff without you. It's a show, Lord. I don't want a show. I'm so tired of shows. I'm so tired of people getting it down and getting their little three bits in a poem. And I'm so tired of this. And I know the little people are so weary with their journey. And they're going, who's going to feed us? We're starving. We're starving. We need somebody to feed us. We don't need salad all the time. Salad patch preachers. Salad patch preachers. Throw you a head of lettuce and expect you to go a week on it. I want some chicken. And I'm wanting some bacon. And I'm wanting some steak once in a while, or a piece of hamburger. I want to get out of the salad patch. I want to grow up and be strong. I want to be full of the Holy Ghost. If you don't give me nothing to nourish me, I'll wilt away. There is a move of God in this house. It's hovering this building. May I prophesy to you, there is a Holy Ghost surrounding these chairs, these walls, and this floor. And he said, I would come if you'll let me. I'll move if you'll let me. I'll help you if you'll let me. You stop looking at my children and my preachers like that's just another person. We're not just another person. That's why she can knock you down, just get around her. That's why. Because that's not you I'm looking at. You can't see me. It ain't me you're looking at. I'm living down here. The real me is in here where you can't see. And the real me is the one that's preaching tonight. If my people would humble themselves and pray. If my people would get in a closet and talk to me a little every now and again. If my people would deny themselves and take up the cross and follow me every day, I would forgive their sin. I would hear from heaven. And I'd heal what they got sick. I'd heal what they got sick. Moses had such a hard task, bless his heart. Well, I don't know who you want me to tell them's come to get them. I sure don't have the strength. Well, just tell them I'm with you. Yeah, just tell them I'm with you. I am a sent you. And it worked. So we go on, and Moses brings the children out. You know why that God sent them? You know why God sent Moses after the children? Because he said, I heard their cries and saw their affliction. I'm telling you, I'm giving you a prophecy. If you will hold fast to the right and you won't let nothing move you, God will fix that thing that's wrong in your life. Not if you pray once a week. Not if you're faithful once a month. Not if you go to church once in a while. But if you're faithful and you say, Lord, here I am. Send me. I want to go. Help me, Lord, and go with me because I'm not going without you. And if you'll hold to that, I guarantee you the promise will be waiting on you. God gave me a particular word while I was in the room, and I said, wow, Lord, that is good, because I fully trust him. God will do the impossible. God spoke to Moses and said, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace in my sight. And I know thee by name. What about a God that knew me when I pulled out in Kentucky? What about a God that was watching me when I walked out to the mailbox to get my mail? What about a God knows my phone number and he don't have to ask nobody? That's the God we serve. That's the God we serve. Then I was reading and I went to Psalms 23. And it said this. Now, if you want goodness and mercy to follow you, then you got to pursue Jesus. If you want goodness and mercy to follow you, then you've got to be pursuing Jesus. That's how we get this. That's how we partake of this. Is we are after him. We are after his will. We are after his way. We're after his word. We're after his love and his mercy. And it follows us. The Bible said in Psalms 23:6, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I pursue Jesus. Goodness and mercy pursues me. I pursue Jesus. I chase after Jesus. I run after Jesus. I seek to find more of him. Seek me, he said. Draw nigh to me, and I'll draw nigh to you. Oh, yeah. Draw nigh to me, then I'll draw nigh to you. Give me your heart, and I'll give you whatever you ask for. All that you ask for, Jesus said, anything you ask my Father in my name, he'll give it to you. That's how real it is. It's so real, it's realer than what I'm looking at right now. Amen. It's so real, it's realer than these blue chairs, and I know they're there. If I chase after Jesus, goodness and mercy is going to chase after me, because the mercy of the Lord looks over a lot of my ignorance and says, my baby, she really didn't understand, and she wouldn't have done that. My baby really didn't understand. She wouldn't have said that. She would not hurt you. Sister Billy, I would let somebody hit me in the face before I would hurt you. That's the truth, so help me. Or anybody else in here. Because if I'm looking for mercy and goodness to chase after me, then I've got to be chasing after God. He said if I would seek him first, the rest of the things would be added to me. I believe that. I believe that. Because when the devil tries to cut my life cord, he tries to shut me down. And he says to me, what you going to do now? I said, well, just hold on to your britches, because I'm fixing to get delivered. Just hold on just a little bit. I'm fixing to get what I'm after. Well, it don't sure don't look like it. He talks country, you know. It sure don't look like it to me. You and Don running all over the country, you in a mess. And the Lord said, cast your care on me. Cast your care on me. I'm the one that's going to take care of things. Strength, Lord. strength, Lord. For I can see the need inside thy heart, inside thy body, and thy mind. And I am the God that watches over you. And I'm the God that promised that I would take care of you. And I keep my promises. Chasing after Jesus. Like a deer chasing after water in the mountain. I said, even the little animals know how to go get a drink when they're thirsty. Even the cows in the cow fields. I don't know much about this stuff. I'm just trying to remember. Yeah, pastor. Even the cows in the pasture, when you get close to where they're fixing to go eat, here they all go, just steady pace right behind each other. I'm going to eat because that's where I eat. I'm hungry. I got to give me something to eat. And I know where it hits right down there. And I'm following her, and she's following her, and he's following her. And we're all going to go have a picnic. And you know what you think sometimes? The children of the Lord, they forgot where they got the last meal. They forgot that they need some more dinner, some more supper, some more breakfast. You know, we take care of these old bodies. Bless their little hearts. Yeah, we get mad because we got hungry. We ain't got time to eat because we got church. Have you ever seen somebody that gets mad when they're hungry? I have. They awful, ain't they? Grouchy. Ooh. And I'm thinking, feed them some food. Feed them some food. And they'll pat their foot and eat. Oh, that's the greatest thing. You know, they're happy now. And that's the same way it is in the spirit. God has a promise coming to you. And he is using you in a mighty way. And he said, I'm the one doing the talking. And he said, I'm the one that's taking care of things. I'm the one that's taking care of you. I'm the one that sends you. I'm the one that says what you say. I'm the one that shines through you. And many, many will be the people that you will be blessed through just because of who you are. Hakasitadadamaya. The children of the Lord need to remember there's more food where that came from. I don't have to worry about eating another meal. If I love the Lord, he'll say, Wanda, here's what I want you to do. Go back down there and get you some good food. Because if you don't, you're going to backslide. You know what backsliding is? Backsliding is you don't like God's kids. You know, most people don't tell this on their self. They just come sit where they always sit, and ain't nobody knows them and God, and they just kind of keep it that way. And they call it, they grow cold. I'm indifferent. But I say, you don't like God's kids, you can't go to heaven. That's the first one we do. If it hadn't been for her, she did that. She caused that. I know she did. And look at her, clapping her hands like she ain't done nothing. Yeah, they bold. They bold. I was sitting in a big arena in a gospel singing. And there was a person came in. I was sitting up in the back row. A person came in and squatted down on the floor because they knew me. And they was just trying to say hi. They hadn't saw me in a long time. They was trying to say hi to me. And they was a blessed man out shouted everybody in that arena. He stood up and he turned around and told me, take that conversation outside, please. I went, I never said a word. Shook my head, yeah. I said, Lord, I'm glad Brother Don wasn't in here. I'm just thankful Brother Don wasn't in here. He would have took it outside. Yes, he would. Because he loves the Lord and he loves me. I'm the next love to Jesus. But I'm here to say this. If we're not pursuing Jesus, we are backsliding. Because when we don't like God's kids no more, We don't like to read the Word of God no more. We don't like to go in our prayer room because we got laundry and stuff to do. Simple stuff. Just simple. Well, you know them girls waiting on you to have coffee. Call the girls and say to them, I'll be a little bit late, but I'll be there. Don't volunteer and give up your Bible and your prayer. See, I got Jesus in here in the prayer room. He's waiting on me. I got to talk to him just a little bit. He's wanting me. Just be plain and easy understood with people so they'll know where you stand. They ask me what I believe. I say, I believe Jesus. And especially if they get a Holy Ghost blessing. What is your denomination? I go, I'm born again. Washed in the blood. I ain't telling you. I'm a Baptistal, Pentecostal, whatever, Nazareth. Somebody called me the other day, wants me to come to. I don't know. It's not what you are here. I said, I'll be there. You really want me? I am radical. Do you want me? I'm radical. I confess. I ain't playing. I confess. I ain't calm. I confess. Well, if Jesus would have healed you with the polio from your head to your feet, you'd get radical too. If you wasn't supposed to wear no shoes and all of a sudden you got healed and you got to put some shoes on, you'd be radical too, wouldn't you, brother? Well, sure you would. I can see it all over you. You already condemned with it. Amen. So you see, if we're radical because we love Jesus, it's going to make us do. Did you see what she did? What's that mean? That's acknowledging that I know God. That's acknowledging that I got joy unspeakable and full of glory. That's acknowledging that he's been my best friend. Do you want to know this man? Do you know him? He's my king. Have you been born again? Have you been set free? Have you been healed? Have you been delivered? Do you know this man? I know him. He's my king. When I can't help myself. Well, I said, Jesus, looks like they don't like me and you. Jesus, I don't think they like me and you. Well, you know, I perspire, and they sure don't like women to do that. Actually, this is sweat. Yeah, I don't even perspire myself. Just plain sweat. That's what anoints this hanky. But they say, you know, I don't like women. It's bold. I said, I don't either. I don't like them. And they said, I don't like women preachers. I said, I don't either. I don't even believe in them. I don't believe in them. Sister Deanna, the Holy Ghost of heaven has to make us who we are when we don't know what to be. And thank God the devil can accuse us. He gets in the phone booth as soon as I get up. He starts dialing. 911, help, help, bring some reinforcements. There's somebody on the floor and she's acting awful. Somebody's up tonight and she's acting radical. This is the only radical time I have. Ask Brother Don. I'm definitely not radical. Other than when I'm doing the call. But when the call gets to flow and it's like a river. You see, when there's a raging fountain that's coming up out of natural. Oh, it splatters everywhere. It gets you wet if you get around it. Yeah. That's the way the Holy Ghost is. When you're trying to do what God has called you to do, be what he's called you to be, you just, phew. Look at this person. I don't see much of that. I don't either. I don't see too many of them people acting like it. I don't either. Because I mind my business and I know where this comes from. I've never been to a neighbor's house. I've lived there for about 12 years. I go on invitation for people sometime when I got time, but I'm not an intruder. I'm very, very self-conscious with that. But I'm thinking, if you really need me, you're going to tell me that. If you really need me, you're going to say, Sister Wanda, I got a problem. I said, well, baby, what's going on? Little woman called me a few weeks back, crying like a child at midnight, woke me up. I didn't want to answer the phone because I don't get much sleep, but I did. This little woman was on there screaming. Oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. Oh, God, forgive me. I said, what's wrong, baby? She said, Lord, I'm afraid. Lord, I'm afraid, she said. I'm so afraid. I'm afraid something's come out of my house that was so ungodly that God won't love me. I said, let me tell you something. Jesus paid the price that will cover any problem and take care of anything the devil comes to bring against us. He loved us so much, he took his son out of heaven and out of the splendors of glory so I can have peace and joy. Do you honestly think that I got something to scream about that he don't know about? We're not going to inform him. He already knows. He already knows. Since I've been here, I got a phone call. I believe it was probably Monday. My little daughter-in-law called. They don't usually call me when I'm on the road because I'm always busy. She said, Mama. I said, what, baby? She said, no, Mama, everything's okay. Don't get afraid. But your son is in the hospital. They think it might be his heart. So here I am, 500 miles from home almost, and my baby needs me. And I'm saying, do you need me? No, Mama, you stay right there. You stay right there. We need you there. You see what I'm saying? We need you in Father's will. We need you walking upright before him and pleasing him. Because when you kneel down to pray, he's going to say, well, what's wrong, darling? And you're going to say, my baby's in trouble. And he's going to say, I already knew that. I already knew that. I was there when they took him in there. I was there when they laid him in the hospital bed. I was there when the doctor said, it looks like his heart's giving him trouble. So I got everybody praying. I put it on Facebook. I said, everybody that's a friend of mine that knows Jesus, pray. Well, they sent him home. That's the last I know. They sent him home. I'm here to tell you, a little woman walked up to me. Where was I at? Sister Ruthie? It was a little woman walked up to me and said, your son's going to be fine. I said, I'm glad to hear that. Makes me feel good. And it was then that they sent him home. I'm here to tell you prayer works. Prayer works, church folk. Prayer will absolutely cause a dead man to raise. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. They couldn't die around Jesus, and he said, I can do the same thing. They couldn't be sick around him. He said, I can do the same thing. Touch your Jesus. God has a touch for you, baby, a big one, a big one. And he said, you get the things off your mind that's troubling you, and don't let them trouble you another day. And he said, if you do, I'm going to be back to check on you. He means that. Yes, he does. He means that. And so all we have to do is be sure that we're chasing after the Lord. chasing after the Lord. I know I'm worrying you, but I don't have an off button. What do I do? Just keep going. Don't have an off button. God never gave me one with a call. Well, I got this new jacket the other day. Somebody bought this for me since I've been here. Since Santa Claus has been here, and I thought, what's that mean? And I got to tell it, I'm sorry. This little woman and her husband blessed me with this jacket. Because I was at a store a while back. With Joanna and somebody who was with us. Sister Kathy and my little sister. Yeah, Cheryl. I'm not good. I'm forgetful.
Catherine?
Yeah, Catherine. And so we went in the store, and this was the only thing in the store that actually stood out to me. But, you know, we evangelists. Anybody know what that means? Yeah, we got some in here that knows what that means. Well, I thought, that's pretty. And I tried it on. The girl said, that's nice. I said, yeah, I think that's nice. But that's a meal. That's a meal. And I tried to get it put up before they all got finished so they wouldn't see me put it up. So they were all back there still prowling, and I went on up toward the front, and I just sneaked it up. She said, Sister Wanda, where's that jacket at? I said, well, baby, I thought I wouldn't get it this time. What? Well, she caught me gone in my last revival. And she and her husband made up between them, they're going to go get that jacket. And he said to her, you go get that. And you bring it back to Wanda. Wasn't that just precious? You know what? I don't even need this jacket. I don't need these high heels, but I like them. And the Lord wanted me to have it. She couldn't even find it when she went back, run all over the store trying to find that jacket. I'm telling you that God cares about things that I care about. I don't lose no sleep because I got to have another pair of shoes or a jacket or something. And I don't break from the call of God to go get it. And if we're out of town this far away, I'm real careful. Because, Brother Don said, you want to go TJ Maxx? You want to go to Ross's Trashes? I said, oh, inside of me, I said, oh, I do. I do. I said, baby, we won't go right now. But I'm telling you that's how close the Lord is to us. That's how close He is to us. You know, it ain't like we can't do like the children of Israel. We wear the same garment that Jesus comes and it never get dirty if that's what He wants. But He said, I know the thoughts I have for you. I know. And they are thoughts of peace and they're thoughts of having whatever, if we're not too pretty to get in the floor. If I can't crawl in the mud with all this mess, then I can't have it. I'd lay in the mud for you, girl, and some reason the Lord keeps taking me to you. And He knows the courage you need. And He's looking out for you. And He says, I got some courage just for you. And I'm going to make you strong. He said, I'm going to make you strong. You got to be willing to keep on going. And don't let that thing stop you or slow you down. Because He's got it. And you can't tell him how you need it because he already knows. And you can't say, Lord, I ask you, and you hadn't come yet. He's coming. He's coming. You watch and see. Keep your eyes open. When you're least expecting, he'll be there. Listen, I sat down on a pew one night, and I had been so sick. For 3 years, this was my little experience I was telling you a while ago. For 3 years, I'd go and come from church. Couldn't do nothing but cry. Wasn't worth a dime to nobody. Couldn't take care of my children. I'd cry, and I couldn't eat. Just all kinds of mess. And I'd sit, and I'd go, and I'd think, well, I got to go to church. So I'd go to church. Because I thought, well, somewhere down this road, God's going to meet me. And so I walked in one night, a little church. I didn't belong there, just a little tiny church. Had wooden pews, and I just sat down, you know, not thinking. Just I was there, taking me another church night. Sat down there. Well, I was sitting on the seconds, you know, over here, room for somebody to sit down. Somebody got beside of me and sat down. I did not see them. But I knew somebody sat down in that seat beside of me. And I just sat there and I thought, well, that must be the Lord. And I'm here to tell you, when the Lord scooted in on that little bench beside of me, things started changing in my life. God began a healing in my heart, my mind, and my soul. My everything was sick. From that night to this night, I've been preaching the gospel like hell's on fire, and it is. And there is a move of God going on, girl. Let me tell you, it might start at your feet and make its way to your head. I don't know which way it's going, but it is going. It's starting. And you know what you're going to have to do? Just get before the Lord, go to church, read the Bible, say, hey, me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. And we don't need nobody to tell us what it's all about. But he said, I'm going to start, and I'm going to finish this job. I'm telling you that God said, take courage and set your sights on high. Don't look down because it ain't down there. It's up there. Don't worry because it's nothing to worry about because he's a holding on. All he needs you to do is hold on. He's making something out of you that you need made. He's taking you away from yourself so you can be what he's planned for you to be. We can do nothing without God as long as we're in charge. I just read and was about to read the scripture when the Lord sent me back here to you. Except the grain of wheat fall into the ground and die. And die. That means all my will, all my way, what I think about things, what I would suggest, all of that has to just be left behind. And then that he brings forth from that is going to be a blessing to many people if you will hear him tonight. That he's bringing forth. But in the ground, in that dying stage, in the real food or in our spirits, in that dying stage, the storms come. The winds blow. The darkness comes. And you're thinking, and I'm thinking, I don't like dark. But all of those days of darkness that I struggled through, that night the Lord sat down by my side, and I knew there was a change on the way. So you hear what I'm saying by the power of God. There is a change on the way. And it may take a few days. But you know what? You grab that Bible and you say, we're going to do this, Lord. We're going to do this. And when the Lord is through, you're going to be a mighty warrior. You hear me? You're going to be a mighty warrior. Because when somebody else looks at you and they say, well, I'm going through this thing and I don't know what to do with it. You know what? You're going to say, I got the answer. How can you have an answer if you've never been there? And we say to God, God, I don't want to do this. This hurts. I don't like this. It's just, this is scary. I don't like this. This makes me afraid. It makes me sad. It makes me weak. It makes me sick. I mean, it's awful. But when I get through it, somebody else can be blessed. Isn't that amazing? That's amazing. That the things that we come through is for that other person. Isn't that amazing to you? All of the things that we've chased after the Lord for, and mercy and goodness is chasing us down, and the enemy's over here going, you'll never make it this time. And I always say, Lord, I can't go if you don't go. Just like Moses just said, can't go. I can't go, Lord, if you're not going. I'm not going. There's no safety out here. And besides that, when I stand up, Lord, I won't know what to say. Moses didn't get to use that excuse. He said, I can't talk. I sound horrible. I used that one too. My daddy wouldn't let me go to school. He said, Jesus is coming. He said, you can stay home, baby, if you want to. You tell mommy, daddy said you can stay home. I said, I'll tell her. And I took off to mommy. Daddy said, I can stay home. Well, all right. You see, back then, daddy got his way. You know what I'm saying? Daddy's got his way back then. But I didn't get my schooling. But you know what I'm talking about, don't you? You're not misunderstanding me, are you, baby? You know exactly what I'm saying. I'm a little flat. I don't have no, what do they call it? English? Good grammar? What do they call it? I don't even know what they call it. I don't even know what I ain't got, but I don't have it. But I know one thing, when the Holy Ghost got inside of me at 14 years old, God called me and said, you're going to do great things. I said, I can't. He said, I'm going with you. I said, if you don't go, I'm not going. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'm going with you all the way to the finish line. Just hang on. Hang on to me. I'm going. Hang on. No matter what happens, don't give up. No matter what happens, don't give in. Don't give in to that enemy. All he wants is your soul. He don't care how much you sing. He really don't care how much you go to church. Just don't get no fire in there. Don't start doing stuff like that. You know better. And people will stare at you. And you know they will. They ain't seen it in 2 or 3 years themselves. Everybody in the house is checking out. What's wrong with her? She got a sickness. Yes, she's sick of being dead. Sick of being dead. Sick of being separated. Sick of doing without joy. Sick of having no peace. Sick of being sick. Sick of being thrown away. Sick of feeling alone. God's got a word tonight, and it's for you. You got to hang fast, because there's something that the enemy wants you got. If you didn't have nothing, he wouldn't want it. That's your proof. See, Christian folks, they lost their proof of purchase. They go, well, I really don't know. I used to live good. Yeah, I used to be close to the Lord. I had a little uncle like that. He told all of his miracles. He used to be so close to Jesus. I loved him better than anything. But I thought, we need some of that now, today. We need some of that today. We need some folks that'll just get up and just be crazy. Now, people that don't want you to be crazy, they will down it. I'm going to be crazy anyway. Don't call me if you don't want me. You know, you get the package. Me and Jesus and the Holy Ghost dance. Me and Jesus and just... You saw how odd Brother Al and Sister Billy was acting a while ago. I mean, they run all over his house, dancing and a twirling. And I thought, well, that is so sweet. But now they wouldn't be allowed to do that everywhere. Disturbing church. Disturbing church! That works! You don't be disturbing church, baby. Because you know you have to be all down and out if you're going to go to church. You're going to go home that way. Your husband's going to leave you because he can't stand you because you're grouchy. Yeah, you close that joy down. He don't need you. But the joy of the Lord in loving Him and serving Him, it is worth more than silver and gold. Nothing can compare to it. Do you know that? There ain't nothing can compare to it. You give me a big mansion and take my Holy Ghost, I'd say I'll live in a hut till Jesus comes. I don't want to try to live without Jesus. He's my healer. He's my joy. He's my peace. He's my comfort. And there is a joy like a liquid that God has poured over your life. And because the joy that is poured over your life is so obvious that all you have to do is be there. And when that smile of God comes out, they say, oh, I needed this. I needed this today. And He said, there's going to be more. And He said, I'm going to show you that I'm the God of strength. I'm the God of courage. And I'm a God of miracles and wonders. And your enemy wants you to fall. And God said, I'm holding you. Sometimes my mind gets so wrapped up in trouble, and my heart gets so heavy too. Sometimes I get so low, I feel like touch bottom. Then He reaches out and He pulls me through. I pray my way out of trouble, and I ask the dear Lord to show me the way. I prayed my way out of trouble, and His dear nail-scarred hand wiped my teardrops away. And the smallest prayer from the world's biggest sinner brings a smile to His saddened face. So I just go to Him anytime I'm in trouble. He washed my soul from burdens, and He gives me His strength. I prayed, help's coming, my way out of trouble, and I asked the dear Lord to help me each day. I prayed my way out of trouble. And his dear nail-scarred hand wiped my teardrops away. God's going to honor you, because since you came to this house, you have been declaring how great it is to be in the house of the Lord, and that you see the importance and wonder, Lord, what's wrong with the people? God said, I will honor you with blessings because you have this desire. So if you want to get out of trouble, you pray. My little grandson came to me. He's about probably 25. I don't have no lost grandchildren. One of my little girls, she's she's having a little time getting through her hot pockets. Because if she gets mad, she'll backslide. But she'll say, oh, the Lord is good, you know, tomorrow. She's just, the Lord is so wonderful. I said, I love you, baby. She said, Mama, I love you so much. But my little grandson, he'd work night shift. He'd have to go to work about 3 in the morning. I said, baby, you got to be praying. Anybody know what prayer means? I said, baby, you got to be praying. He's a good little boy. Well, he said, Mama, I do pray. I said, well, what do you do of a morning? You start your day out with prayer. Well, Mama, I get up at 3. I don't know where I could fit that in. I said, get up an hour early. I'm telling you, it's got benefits. People don't know that. I tell you, they don't know that. When my daughter was healed with cancer, my son was took care of when the rock tried to kill him in the mines. My daughter was went blind and God healed her. And so many things, so many miles on the highway with them traveling, so many miracles and wonders. And one day I touched my knee and I felt it was rough. Oh, what on earth is going on with my knee? They were both rough. Come to find it out, I'd been praying. Yeah, I got some prayer scars. Prayer scars. Now don't ask me what to do. I already told you, if you'll pray, God will change things for you. I said, God will change things for you if you pray. Don't say, I remember my great-grandmama, she was a praying woman. My daddy was the preachingest man God ever called. Well, get up and do some of it. Get up and do some of that stuff. Do weird stuff. Get on your knees. The devil says, what you doing down on your knees? And then the phone rings. You go, well, I'm not answering it. The devil said, you better. That's probably one of your babies. I'm here to tell you and declare to you and prophesy to you this night, prayer will change everything in your life. You will stop seeing yourself the same. You will stop seeing yourself the same. And you know what? When people hurt your feelings, you know what you do about it? No problem. No problem. You ain't got time to go there. You ain't got time to go there. When you go there, you miss a step. Because I'm here to tell you that the devil's got all kinds of pickers out there wanting to pick you. Yeah, they just like somebody pinching you all the time. Slow down. You're going too much. You shouldn't never went to Sister Deanna's. You didn't feel like it. You had too many places to go. That's the devil's words. I said, well, if you'd have went, you'd have seen how good it was. Yeah. If you would have went, devil, you would have seen how good it was. We had us some church and some dinner, lunch. See, I have lunch and dinner both at the same time. I don't know what it, I don't know which one I have them. I have them both. God's got some great blessings for us. And I'm here to tell you it's in this house. The Word of God has been flowing through here like a river. The Word of God has been flowing through here like a river. If you chase after Jesus, grace and mercy is going to chase after you. And when you turn around and you wonder, well, did you see how close that come to me? Mm-hmm. Grace and mercy got you out of the way. Joanne, you couldn't travel all over this country safe without God. Could not do it. So tonight, I want you to do something for me. I want you to, if you want to pray, then that's what we want to do. If you want prayer, that's what we want to do. But I honestly feel like that God has come in this house tonight through His Word. I really feel that. And I feel that He wants you to leave here completely delivered from your own mind. See, our mind keeps us down. Our mind. Our mind says, but what if? There ain't no what if in God. God speaks it and it's there. He said, let there be light, and it's been shining ever since. He ain't weak, is He? Take this home with you. God has got all power, and He's looking for some people that'll believe Him. Bring it back. Bring it back, He said. Bring back the people. Bring them back. Bring back unity. Come on back and stop being so sophisticated and so dignified. So when I got my preacher's license, yeah, you know you can get your little PhD thing. DD, whatever they call it. Well, I said, well, you know, I've been preaching for years. I don't know. I'm not about to change. So if that's going to change me, I'll stay the way I am. They said, well, what you need to do, you're going to run up on some dignified people. And when you do, they're going to ask you, who's your daddy? Who do you know? Do you know anybody important? Do you know Dr. Bishop? No. Don't know him. Well, do you know this big mega church preacher? Call his name. Well, I've heard of him. Don't know him. Well, we'll call you sometime, Sister Wanda. But if I know them preachers, if I knew them preachers, I could go. So I act dumb. They don't even know I know what they're doing. I go, all right, I'll be calling you, all right. I said, you want to pay for me a certificate? I'll take it. You want to pay for it? They paid for it. Ain't changed a bit. It's just sitting up there gathering dust. That's all. My certificate is the Holy Ghost. And I know if I had every degree they are, that it wouldn't make me who I am. What make me who I am is my prayer bones, fasting, and going in the will of God. Now, fasting is in style. It just came back in 2016. And if we don't start fasting and praying, I'm afraid America will never come back. It might not anyway. It might not. They tell me that things are being set up against the Christian now everywhere. The governmental laws are coming against the children of God. That's the only people they worry about is the children of God. And you know what? That's the only safety they have and don't even know it. And tonight, if you have anything in there that's bothering you, hindering you, stopping you, slowing you down, if there's somebody that's crossed your path and you can't get peace about it and you can't like them no more, the altar. And that's another thing. We better bring our altar back alive. We better bring our altars back. I really get tired of pastors having me to come, and as soon as I finish, they go, "See you tomorrow." I'm thinking, I've not got settled down now the Holy Ghost yet. Give me a few minutes. Yeah, let the people at least, you know, soak it up just a minute. We need some leaders. You know, I don't have the strength these days because I am a full-time evangelist. But I said, Lord, if I was called back into pastoral work, the altar would be my number one. That'd be my number one job. Because when I was growing up, they lined in the altars. And you know what? They got what they went for. They got what they went for. And when I got in the altar at 13 and 12 and 14, I was digging for the Holy Ghost and fire. I didn't want to make believe. I didn't want something that was quiet and peaceful. I wanted something that had power in it. And I said, God, I want to dance in these pews. I want to run these aisles. I want to be crazy. Because all the young people was crazy but me. And I just stand and stare at them. Because I was shy. Nearly killed me. Dead. That's what a lot of my whippings was over. I said, you're going to get up, girl, and you're going to dance. I said, I can't dance, Lord. I'm shy. Well, he said, you got to have another chastising then. You know what I done when he got finished? I wrote a song called I Believe. After I wrote that song, I got like I am now. I said, Lord, I ain't got nothing to be ashamed of. Shoot, I can preach with one shoe. I can do anything. You know, I would not have done that. No, honey, you'll not catch me undone. I preach without this jacket, but now I just can't go there. I'm dead. I'm telling you, I preach with my dress hanging sideways. And the devil said, you're a mess. I got one more little thing, and I'm going to leave you alone. I know you want me to go. But I know you ain't tart as I am. These concrete floors kill you, won't they? Brother Don and me, we went to revival just before we came here. We came out the hotel room and brought our little cart with our stuff on it, and the man ain't never made a mistake since I've been traveling these roads, not one. And the devil blinded him from my jewelry case, and he run over it. I said, what was that bump? He got out and run right over my jewelry. I mean, you would have thought somebody got in there with a hammer and twisted it all and everything. I thought, I've never seen this. This is unreal. I got to church, and a little woman came up to me and brought me this little bracelet. She didn't know the story. She said, Sister Wanda, I left home, and the Lord said, take that, Sister Wanda. And I told her my story. She said, ooh, that makes me feel so good that I went ahead and obeyed the Lord and didn't know the story. I said, that's wonderful. And I just bragged on her because I know how hard it is to obey the Lord when he wants you to give away something you won't keep. Well, my mirror was about this round, and I have to take one to see the back of my head, you know, when I'm trying to get together. That mirror was in a million pieces, looked like. And I wanted him to pick it up real easy and carry it to the garbage. And he just stuffed it back down in my stuff. And I said, baby, don't do that. You're getting glass everywhere. I'm not wanting nobody to see me, he said. We went on to our next meeting. We had 4 days in Pigeon Forge, and we went to that meeting. I carried some little light stuff because I'm not supposed to be carrying big stuff, and he won't let me anyway. I picked up my little light toiletries, had my curling iron, you know, things like that in it, and my Lazy Susan for my little carousel for my coffees. So I thought, I can carry this much, and I had my coffees. My creamers. Love my creamers. And I stuck my key in. It didn't work. And I said, I'm going to have to run back down there and get this key fixed. And it was one flight. Went down that one flight. And he was going up a flight to bring my things to me. And in that instant of time, somebody stole my stuff right in front of the door. Sure did. Sure did. So, you know, the devil, he despises this joy. He despises. He knew I was coming to Pennsylvania. I'm going to tell you, we got the God of glory on our side. He didn't want me coming out here telling you, you can do this. You can do this. Well, we got ready for another revival. I was going through my closet. I was getting ready for this long journey to Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and all this. All this traveling and places, and I was trying to get everything together. Well, I think I was getting ready for one church service before I left, and I missed a dress. And I said, Don, where's my dress? I can't find my dress. Well, I don't know, honey. I don't know. I said, oh, we've left that at the hotel. Now, all this stuff's going on. I mean, right in a line. So he called the hotel, and they said, we got your dress. Well, some of our friends was coming to the meeting where we was going that night, and they lived around the vicinity, picked my dress up at the hotel. Well, I got ready to come here and was loading up the rest of my stuff. Well, now I got two brand new outfits missing. Not counting that one. They brought that one to me. I said, Don, got two outfits missing that I'm going to take with me. Well, I don't know. Look, I said, I looked. Called the hotel, and they said, we got them. Wow. What about that? That was a pure devil sent me one dress and kept the other two. I said, I've never seen so much of the enemy against me in my life. But he knows I can start out with one outfit. I've done it before. When I started working for the Lord, I had one decent outfit. I said, now, God, you're my father, you're my provider, and if you don't get me some clothes, we're going to look pretty bad because I'm going to keep wearing this. And I'm here to tell you, I proceeded to go. I pursued Jesus. I said, I'm going to church. It's going to be them laughing. Guess who they're going to be laughing at? I'm your child. And I'm here to tell you, and this is a God's honest truth. I had that one little outfit and one pair of shoes. That's all I had, and I was going to church. It didn't matter what it cost. And I went to church. Next thing I knew, I had clothes enough to where I probably wouldn't have to buy no clothes in the next few years. And my husband counted my shoes, said, baby, you got 87 pairs of shoes. I said, no. But I'd dance in that one little pair of shoes. I'd walk the mud in them. I'd go up the street, up the mountains. It didn't matter. I had one pair of shoes. But I was going to the house of God, and I was going to sing my song, and I was going to do what God gave me to do. It didn't matter. You know, if you don't like my shoes, just turn around and enjoy the song. He said, yes, you have, baby. You got that many shoes. And I'm telling you, I tell this regular because I know women especially need to hear it. Men don't understand women because Don wants to know what I do with that many shoes. Well,